I'm Freeholder Deputy Director Ed McDonald. As a liaison to the Department of Veterans Affairs, I work to serve and honor our veterans every day. One important way to honor those who have served is to ensure we preserve the history of Camden County's veterans. In partnership with the Rutgers Oral History Archive, we've created a series of documentaries that feature the history and experiences of our local veterans during their time of service to our country. The first in the series is The Voices of Camden County's Veterans, World War II in the Pacific. To get a first peek at upcoming videos, be sure to like us on Facebook.
The real war will never get in the books. Writing from Camden, New Jersey, in his later years, poet Walt Whitman wrote these words as he reflected on the horrors he saw during the Civil War. 150 years later, his words have held true for every conflict in which Americans have fought since then.
You know, you're scared the hell out of me on the ship. The Marines were firing at 20 millimeters before the fight. I figured, oh hell, they must be close.
These are the faces of only a handful of Camden County, New Jersey's remaining World War II veterans. Americans for whom memories of real war, horrific battles, tragedy, and courage under the most trying of times, and service around the globe live on 7 decades after the guns of the Second World War fell silent. At a time when most young people are looking to further their education or start careers and families, these veterans were called upon to form part of a military operation that would stretch across the Pacific to strike and defeat the forces of Imperial Japan.
I remember sitting in a tent.
Here, they will share their stories so that succeeding generations may try to have an understanding of the World War that engulfed the days of these veterans' youth. On December 7th, 1941, news of the Japanese attack on the American base at Pearl Harbor, Hawaii, spread across the nation like wildfire. By nightfall, millions of young men and women knew that their nation was at war, and the course of their lives would be forever altered. Edward Hill was born in the Fishtown section of Philadelphia. In 1927, his family moved to the Delaware section of Pennsauken, New Jersey.
Had a room, one spare room, so my mother advertised for room, and one fellow from the Geekers came over, and my mother was giving him room and board for $15 a week. But he eventually became a scoutmaster that day. We had a Boy Scout troop. When the war started, we were at a Boy Scout camp someplace in Camden County. I don't know which one it was now. And we heard it over the radio that the Japs had bombed Pearl Harbor.
John Lauriello was born and raised in Southwest Philadelphia.
I was like everybody else in those days. I had just finished high school. And I was at my aunt's house in South Philadelphia, 24th Street, and the radio blared out that Pearl Harbor had been attacked. It was a Sunday afternoon. And the first question was, where in the hell is Pearl Harbor? In those days, nobody knew where Pearl Harbor was. So, 18 years old, you hear that your country's been attacked. So, it works on you.
Linwood Allen, known as Stu to his friends, was born in Vergen, New Jersey, and raised in nearby Jefferson.
I graduated from Glassboro High School in 1940. I intended to go further on until things happened at Pearl Harbor and so forth, but I was just at home on a quiet day for me, I guess, when the word came, and we got a radio report, I guess, that this had happened. And my immediate reaction was to start thinking about the Marine Corps.
John Welsh was born in the East Falls section of Philadelphia. His family lived in several neighborhoods before settling in Germantown.
I was working at the Army Quartermaster's at that time. I was at 41, and in July I joined the Marine Corps, 42. A lot of my friends joined up the Marine Corps right away. In fact, a couple of them were in the 1st Marine Raiders, and one of my very best friends, a school chum, he's missing in action at Guadalcanal.
John Welsh joined the 21st Marines in the 3rd Marine Division. After training overseas in New Zealand and then Guadalcanal, Welsh fought in the Bougainville Campaign from November 1943 to January 1944. Later, he again found himself in combat when the 3rd Marine Division invaded Guam on July 21st, 1944. Soon after the Guam landing, Welsh and his unit moved into positions on the cliffs above the landing beaches.
We set up perimeter up when we got up at the top of the cliffs. And that night, the next couple of nights, we had banzai attacks, or bonsai, whatever the hell you want to call it. They never got to our position because we saw them coming and we let them have it. Everybody was firing at the same time. And they got knocked down and retreated. Those who could retreated. You react as to what your training did for you or trained you to do. And that's what we did. When I went into this war, I didn't give a damn whether I lived or I died. Only thing I prayed for was that I didn't come home in a basket. I didn't have to have somebody taking care of me. So, but if I died, my mother got my insurance, made things easier for her. And if I lived, fine. Which I did. I was very, very fortunate. Squad that I was in, we were selected to go on patrol behind a tank. And we're going up this road behind this tank, and all of a sudden the tank turns off. And he was heading right into a tank trap. I saw where he was going. I ran around the front and tried to wave him off. But as I got around the front, we got hit with a mortar. And I was thrown on my face right in front of the tank. The other guys in the back, they were all hitting the legs. One guy was killed. I got up and the tank stopped about the same time. And then he backed off. So the four of us are back there. We're trying to figure out what the hell to do. And he takes off going back to our lines. So I ran after him because I had legs. I got hit in the upper back and stopped the tank, and the other guys hobbled up to it, and the tank captain got out. What do you want? I said, help us. We need to get out of here. These guys are all hit. He said, well, climb aboard. I said, they can't climb aboard. You need to come out and help them. But so he did. We got all four of us got on the tank, and they went back to the line, back to our lines, back to the cliff. And they took us down the cliff and to a makeshift hospital that they had, where they had dug it out of the land. And that night I got overtaken by mosquitoes. And woke up the next morning with dengue fever.
However, the battle for Guam was not over for Welsh and his wounded fellow Marines. The next morning, another Japanese banzai attack broke through the lines.
They broke through the lines, and I commandeered a jeep, a and got the other three guys out. And I figured, what the hell? No sense of me standing here because I didn't even have a rifle. When we got on that tank, one of the guys got stuck with my bayonet, and he grabbed my rifle and threw it the hell away. So I didn't even have a rifle. So I jumped on the Jeep, too. They took us down to the beach, and I went aboard a hospital ship there, the USS Bountiful. Guy operated on me and took some of the shrapnel out of my back, gave me a shot of phenobarbital. They put me in a sack. I went to sleep, and I had dengue fever. They call it breakbone fever. It hits all your joints. I went to sleep from this phenobarbital, and I dreamed they cut off both my legs to cut off the pain. And I was happy. In my dreams, that is. Fortunately, it was a dream.
After recuperating from his wounds and the dengue fever, Welsh returned to the 21st Marines in February 1945 for the invasion of Iwo Jima, where he earned another Purple Heart for wounds received in action.
You know, I just thought, well, I'd like to see some action. That's why I joined really the Navy after Midway. I mean, a lot of men joined the service right after Midway. I mean, we figured, oh, hell, the war's over. Let's get in and get some action. But the war wasn't over. It wasn't over until 45.
Edward Hill trained as an electrician's mate at Newport, Rhode Island. He soon joined a crew of a brand-new Essex-class aircraft carrier, the USS Intrepid. The Intrepid began its first combat tour in January 1944. On February 17, 1944, while conducting operations against Japanese forces from Truk Island, the Fighting Eye, as the Intrepid was nicknamed, was struck by an enemy aerial torpedo.
I said he couldn't see this plane coming in. It was below radar. And it hit, the torpedo hit the aft end of the ship. It knocked our two starboard screws out and then jammed the rudder up into the hull of the ship. Now all we were doing was going around in circles. And I was in an electrical shop, which is about midway in center of the ship. And the ship got hit and rocked side to side. And somebody says, holy hell, we got hit with a fish. Now, I say the ship rocked side to side. Now that torpedo put a hole 30 feet in diameter below the waterline. That's a lot of water. And as it did, it went all the way up through to the flight deck. Naturally, it got smaller as it went up. Somebody had gotten a brilliant idea to get sailing, put sails in front of the prop plane to get steering. Now, how that worked, I don't know, but it worked. And I say we got far enough out where we got towed into Pearl Harbor, where they made temporary repairs to get into Hunter's Point. I know there was four men killed in the after auxiliary steering room. But how many else men were? I don't know. Some of them might have been blown over the side. They were still in their gun mouths. But I don't honestly know. But I think there's only four men that I know of where we had barrel at sea for those men.
After repair, the Intrepid returned to the Pacific in June, engaging in campaigns stretching from the Marshalls to the Philippines. On October 30th, 1944, Hill and his crewmates were introduced to a terrifying new form of warfare, the Japanese kamikaze suicide planes.
The kamikaze hit the number 10 gun mount. Now that's a steward's mate, but they were really gunner's mate, operated that gun mount. And the plane hit the gun mount, which was 20 millimeter guns, and killed at least 10. How many more were wounded, I don't know, quite a few. Now these men, it was segregated at that time in the service. Some of them were eligible for medals almost immediately, but most of them didn't get them until the 1990s, which they should have got a long time ago.
The Intrepid would withstand four more kamikaze attacks. the deadliest of which came on November 25th, 1944, when two kamikazes hit the ship within 5 minutes. 6 officers and 59 crewmen were killed, and the ship was badly damaged.
We got hit with a kamikaze and a bomb. Now, they hit a 500-pound bomb, which went right through the flight deck into the hangar deck. Now, our number 3 elevator was the weakest point of the ship, because you hit that number 3 elevator, there's a 5-inch handling room right below it. Now, that's what they were aiming for, that 5-inch handling room. But he missed the flight elevator pit, and he hit on the hangar deck. Now, that 500-pound bomb put a hole in that hangar deck about 18 inches deep and bounced up and exploded onto the hangar deck. Oh, it almost wiped everything out, planes and men or whatever it was on the hangar deck. And I say that the hangar decks are six or eight inches special steel, and that bomb still put that much damage on the hangar deck. Now, our damage control officer was a commander, and he had some other men, and they were trying to roll a torpedo over the side. All they ever found of that commander was a piece of his thumb. I guess the torpedo exploded, which did a heck of a lot more damage on the hangar deck. Now, this hangar deck, shrapnel went from, I don't know which was the torpedo or the bomb, staunchions that raised the elevators. And they were 3/4-inch stainless steel thick. So it goes through one side and out the other side. And then it landed went through 4 bulkheads. And it wound up in an electrical box where it stopped. I mean, it finally stopped. To me, that's the only thing I was really in danger of, all the other bombing and torpedoes hit the ship, because I was only 25 feet away on the third deck. But this all happened on the second deck. Second deck were on the elevator, number 1 elevator, with them staunchions that go in the thing. So that's the only close danger I ever had on the ship, because my general quarter station was number 3 general quarter station on the third deck, on the officer's quarters forward. But once we got hit with one of these kamikazes in a, I don't know whether it was a pilot's handling room or whatever it was, right below the flight deck. But it was all fire in there, whole fire in it. So they wanted volunteers to go into that room to see what they could do. I mean, I went in, I picked up a man's head that was completely charred. He didn't know who it was. So I took him out and put it in a bucket or something, I don't know. Went back in, I picked up a man's foot, completely burned. That was enough for me, I couldn't take it anymore.
Later, Hill remained on board the repaired Intrepid through its duty during the American occupation of Japan. He later served on the destroyer Leary and the special anti-aircraft cruiser Fresno before being discharged from the Navy in 1948. Stu Allen trained as an aircraft mechanic. At Cherry Point, North Carolina, he joined Marine Bombing Squadron 443, a unit flying PBJ bombers, which was the Marine Corps designation for the Air Corps' B-25 Mitchell medium bomber. His unit was deployed to the Bismarck Archipelago off New Guinea and began flying missions in August 1944.
Emeru was an island that had already been taken over and had only had a few Japanese on it, so it was cleared out, and CBs were in making runways. As a matter of fact, it's very easy to make a runway on some of those islands because they're coral islands. And once you clear that late underbrush off, you actually have a runway there. So we had two runways, a fighter runway and a bomber runway. At one time, Joe Foss, who was probably one of the best, most successful fighter pilots in the Marine Corps, his squadron was there and was escorting our planes on bomber missions. And I remember one little incident that happened there. Speaking of Joe Foss, one of his fighter planes crashed right on the edge of an ammunition dump and caught fire. and a young fellow from our outfit who was a member of the crash crew, but he wasn't on duty, was nearby there, and he rushed into the flames and he pulled the pilot out, and unfortunately, the man was alive then, but he unfortunately died afterwards. And Joe Foss presented a medal to the fellow from our outfit that saved him at that point. Just a little incident that happened after we got there. Nimitz said, if we cut off the major bases from supplying the rest of the Japanese, we'll be in better shape and we'll save these landings, which is really what they did and was really why we had the B-25s over there. Although we were not in danger with landings and so forth, we were in danger with getting planes shot up and losing some planes. We lost several planes. I was a crew chief, so it was my job to keep one plane flying. But we got to a point where some planes were getting hit and you'd lose an engine. We'd have holes in the side and the fuselage or something. So they developed what they called a check and engine change crew, and I became in charge of the check and engine change crew. So we had to change some engines and we had to patch up some fuselages and stuff like that. So that became kind of a major operation, because there was always, even though we kept all their planes grounded, they couldn't really get up. Once in a while, they would get a fighter plane off, and we would have to run for a foxhole or something because one was coming in. But they were always shot down or driven away before they really ever did any damage to us. But there were mop-up operations to be done in the Philippines because there were a lot of people. In fact, there were people there years later didn't even know the war was over. You know, they were living in jungles and stuff. So our planes were moving into there, into Mindanao. We were at the same time sending planes back to Hawaii to be refitted. And my engineering officer came up, and this is when replacements were coming in. And he said, 433 has a plane going back to Hawaii for refitting, and they need a crew chief, so I'm sending you back to Hawaii. Now, he said, you'll be leaving the day after tomorrow. So I said, okay, what could I say? And he came to me the next day and he said, you know, I just looked at the list and you're the next guy to be replaced. He said, if I send you to Hawaii, he said, you're liable to be out here another 2 or 3 months. But he said, a guy named Thielen, Art Thielen, who was in my crew, he said, he's been bugging me to go to Hawaii. So how about if I send him in your place? So I said, it's okay with me. So the next day they took off for Hawaii. On the way back to Hawaii, you stop at Palmyra Island, which is a refueling center about halfway between there and Hawaii. As they were coming in for a landing, the plane blew up, and they were not only all killed, but they never recovered the bodies. But the guy who took my place was a good friend of mine, and he worked in my crew, and it was a sad affair that he had to suffer for that, or he had to lose his life because of that.
The medium bombers of the 443rd and other Marine Corps bomber squadrons, together with the U.S. Army Air Corps and naval forces, successfully isolated Japanese units on the island fortress of Rabaul, neutralizing its more than 100,000 Japanese troops for the rest of the war. John Lauriello became a communications specialist and joined the 27th Marines, 5th Marine Division, at Camp Pendleton, California. Later, while training in Hawaii, he was introduced to one of the Marine Corps' secret weapons, the Navajo Code Talkers.
This one particular day, one of the higher NCOs come out with these three Navajo Indians, but he explained what they're going to do. They're going to relay messages in Navajo code talk. And we all had the same attitude. Oh, yeah, you know, I've seen this before. Flat on the face and all that stuff. But, of course, nobody says anything, so you listen. They put on a demonstration which was totally impressive. They not only used their language, but they developed a code inside of their language so that if another Navajo heard what they were talking about on the radio, they would never understand them. And that was the basis of the Navajo code talk. And they put on a demonstration, and a thing that would take us a half an hour to transmit, they did in 15 seconds because they were all bilingual. You could write the message in English. They would look at it in English, speak it in Navajo code, and a little voice on the other end would come back and say, Roger, like within 15 seconds. How long did it take, you know? When we did it, we did the code, and we used to put the code through a haggling machine, which encoded it even more, mixed everything up, you know, and then on the other end, the messages that we sent would have instructions at the top, how to set their machine up to get it back again, you know. It was quite complex, but the Navajos, they nixed all that stuff. They were hands down, marvelous, marvelous guys.
Lauriello became friendly with one code talker in particular, Paul Kimicini. Toward the end of 1944, the 5th Marine Division began its preparations for the invasion of Iwo Jima.
31st of December, New Year's Eve, 1944, they put us on the ship and sleeping quarters and all were down in the holds, you know, the cargo holds. But I got myself a shelf and slid into it. And I look around down the end and there's Paul with his feet towards mine. You know, we're at the same level. And I said, well, fine, great, great. And again, he was always with me. Nice guy, couldn't be any nicer. When we got to Saipan, this is after 50 days on board, which is no pleasure. You're elbow to elbow, shoulder to shoulder, waiting in line for everything. But that's where the food thing took place, where they brought the cargo nets on board. It was at nighttime. They put all the lights on in the mast. It was like a carnival. And our group got called to unload the cargo nets and put the stuff away. And that's when Paul came into play again. He shows me this can of peaches he's got. And I said, hang on to them, very quietly. And they wound up in the I-beams of the ship right above our sack, you know. And we never did eat them because every time he said, let's eat the peaches, John. And I said, no. I said, we're liable to get caught eating the peaches. You know, and I don't want to get involved in something like that. We're eating good. We'll save them to when we really need them, when we're in a place where we could do what we want to do without running a danger of getting disciplined for it, you know. But we never did eat them because right on the beach, he got picked off. In the LCVP, which is a landing craft, the one that we were in, we were both up at the front, right at the ramp, and they had a cart in there, which they called a soup kitchen, which actually held all the spare parts for anything that you wanted to do. Paul and I were to grab the handle of this thing, and the rest of the guys were going to push when we got up to the beach and the ramp went down. So we tried that, and Paul and I grabbed the handle. We came off the ramp, and as soon as the wheels hit the sand, they dug right in almost to the hubs. And our instructions were to drag this thing 30 yards inland and drop it. Well, we got like not even 30 inches from the ramp, and the thing was in so deep that we couldn't move it. So we just abandoned the thing right there. In the meantime, now the ramp goes down, we go on the island. Now we got the smell of gunpowder. We got the smell of sulfur. We got the smell of dead bodies. It all came up, you know, a whole different batch of smells come up, you know. And it was instant death from the sky. They were firing from the Suribachi, which is on the south end. They were firing regular artillery. They were firing artillery that had what's these fuses, proximity fuses, and they had their machine guns going, and they had their mortars going from the south end. And up at the north end, there was, it wasn't a volcano, but it was a cliff, dark brown cliff. And they had everything firing out of there on top of us. And it was all like going up and coming down. And my diagnosis was instant death from the sky, because that's where it hits you from the head, on the shoulders. A couple of guys got ripped right down the front when the things are in a perfect position. You know, they just tear the hell out of you. And there was what they called spider traps along the way. They had these 50-gallon drums, and they were set off in like the shrubbery, except where they could camouflage the leaves with more shrubbery, so you wouldn't even know they were there. And there was snipers in a couple of the trees that were still standing. And it was just plain hell is what it was. People were dropping like flies. Hundreds were killed within the couple of, for the first couple hours that we were there. We were right alongside of a Japanese ship that had been beached. It was all rusted, laying over on the side. And I found out later that there were snipers in there, and they probably got Paul. And after I checked him out, made sure that he was dead, nothing more I could do for him, I left. But the final check on him, his eyes were glazed. And again, I said once before that I could never believe that a guy's eyes could glaze that fast, you know. But he got shot right through the ribs, starting from the left, probably left to the right, took out both lungs and heart at the same time, instant, never knew what hit him. And the pieces went with him.
Lauriello survived all 35 days of the battle for Iwo Jima. Later, after VJ Day, he and the other members of the 27th Marines took part in the occupation of Japan.
Just to show you how things work in military service, I went back to Mojave thinking I was going to go into an F-4U squadron, and they sent me back to North Carolina to go into a PBJ or B-25 squadron, which didn't even have the same kind of engines as an F-4U, so it's...
charge of the crew's galley, and the chief was making bread. Oh, it smelled good. Naturally, bread it smelled good. Well, I asked him if I could have a loaf. He said, get lost. So I did. I went down and I tripped the circuit breaker for the whole galley circuit. Now, if I'd have been caught, I'd have been busted to a premise. I didn't tend to leave it off long. So he called. I knew I'd get a call when it made it. He said, chief, if I can find us right away, can I get a loaf of bread? He said, yeah. So I waited about another minute and went down and put the circuit breaker bed in again. And I say, I know I'd have been busted if I didn't get caught. But I never had any trouble getting any bread after that.
Thank you.
And one of the things they insisted at the induction station was to have all the cavities in your mouth filled before you went to Paris Island, which I, like a goodie, I did, my own private dentist. But you go down there, they put you in a chair, and the dentist proceeds to pull every filling in your teeth out. All the molars that have any hole you had in there are now all bare. And while he's over mixing the amalgam to fill them up again, his assistant is squirting cold air into all your cavities. And I remember looking up and said, you son of a bitch, you know, one of these days I'm going to get you. You're not going to get away with this, right?
Although I said I wasn't afraid to die, I did a hell of a lot of praying. But that's the story of my life.